The episode starts with a group of young people that seem to be living in a closed city. We can assume that they were already born in the apocalypse, or the collapse as they call it, since they don't know if there is anything beyond the walls that surround them. It's like they are living in a bubble while the world around them is rotting. The girl, Mimiheim, is already suspicious of what might be outside the walls and is seen tempting Tokio to go outside with her. Elsewhere, Maru and Kiruko are looting houses in search of food. Just like in any good post-apocalyptic setting, they found some houses where they hadn't gone before, where they find unopened things like a toothbrush and toilet paper, but there isn't much food around anymore. People who haven't died from the apocalypse itself have died from starvation, like a couple they found in the first house. Maru and Kiruko are in search of heaven, although they don't know what it is exactly. On their way, they get ambushed by a couple of disgusting old men, who by their dialogue it seems they were looking not only to rob them but to take advantage of them, as they assumed they were both females. Maru replied instantly that he was a boy, and Kiruko went along with it saying she was a boy as well, but the men didn't fall for it. Kiruko tries to escape, but Maru starts fighting with them. That show how skillful Maru is. Kiruko also has a beamer gun, and even though she wasn't sure if it would work, it did. The gun scared the men, and Maru and Kiruko made them show them their place. Although they didn't find any food in it, they found batteries to charge Kiruko's gun, which was out of batteries. Back in the closed city, Tokio can't sleep and thinks about what Mimiheim told him about outside. Like any curious person who can't sleep, he wanders outside, perhaps trying to find out how to leave the place, to find out if there is anything beyond that place. He gets caught outside by the director of the place, who upon hearing his question about what's beyond that place, she inquires him if he thought of that himself, to which Tokio replies that his friend did. As they resume their journey towards heaven, they end up in an inn. The way that the owner of the inn shows up is already a little bit suspicious, but the two are well welcomed. As they are having a meal together, the owner believes that they are sister and brother and that they are a couple, talking with them about the dangers of incest, but although Maru calls her sister, they aren't related in any way, nor are they dating. Kiruko was simply hired to be his bodyguard. The owner of the inn tells them that there is a monster who lurks out, and that's why she has a gun with her at the inn. Maru and Kiruko offer to kill it, even though guns don't kill it. What's eerie is that at night, when the two are about to go to sleep, they seem to have been drugged by the owner, and they immediately fall asleep. In the room next to theirs, the lady sits with her gun, and the monster, a creature with wings resembling a bird and multiple eyes, shows up in the window. Tokio is seen talking to Chireo, who is in a wheelchair, and he states his opinions about a world existing outside those walls. Upon questioning, Tokio confesses to Chireo that he likes Mimiheim. However, the latter suddenly winces in pain as the shot zooms in on his hand that has odd purple-colored marks. Following this, Tokio throws a tantrum since Kaku receives Kona's drawing, not Tokio. Mimiheim sends an explicit picture of herself to Shiro. Maru and Kiruko waking up after being unconscious, the duo realizes that their food is mixed with something that knocks them out. They encounter the innkeeper and reassure her that they would be able to kill the monster, giving verbal proof of their combat abilities. Kiruko and Maru work well as a team, but when the former is about to take the shot with her gun, the innkeeper intervenes, making her miss her shot. The innkeeper reveals that the monster is her son, who has been protecting her all this while. This leads the duo to conclude the true reason behind running the inn. The innkeeper feeds the guests to the monster that she thinks is her son, but the monster eventually kills her. Maru decides to kill the monster by himself, by dodging its whip-like attacks, and places his hand on the monster's body since he has a special ability to kill cannibals. A stream of energy takes the shape of his hands and penetrates the monster's interiors, crushing its heart in the process. The next morning, the two continue their journey to Tomato Heaven. Maru demonstrates he's a good boy when he hesitates to retake the batteries they gave the now-dead manager. He's rewarded with a hair mask by Kiruko, which makes him blush. They then lower a raft kept afloat by jerrycans down a great cliff that leads to their destination. Neither of them know if there are sharks or crocs in the water, so they row as quickly as possible to land. During a conversation with Kiruko, Maru states his true goal upon reaching heaven. He has a special case that contains an injection containing a drug, which he is supposed to inject the drug into a person that looks like him. In a flashback, a dying young woman named Makura was the one to send Kiruko and Maru on their journey to the place called Heaven. Since Makura offers the gun that the former is currently carrying and asks Kiruko to save Maru with it. Kiruko then tells Maru that it is Makura who has instructed her to take Maru to Heaven, the duo coming across a village that is self-sufficient and dependent on the food that they grow for themselves. At first they wonder if this is Heaven, but they aren't able to find Maru's doppelganger, but ironically someone recognizes her. He even has a photo of the person he calls Takaya Kiruko, an electro kart racer believed to have lost it after killing their brother in a race. When Maru sees the photo, he's amazed by the similarity to Kiruko, who insists she's not that person. The duo then comes across a box that has a stamp matching the insignia carved on Kiruko's gun. They then decide to head back to Tokyo by ship in search of Heaven. After this, Maru confesses his feelings for Kiruko, and then suddenly leans in to try to kiss her, but she seems to have rejected him. He apologizes for forcing himself on her, to which she replies by saying that although her body is that of a woman, she is a man in her mind. A flashback in which we see a character named Haruki who is being bullied by thugs. Just as he was about to be killed by one of them, Robin Inazaki saved him in the nick of time. Kiruko, who was in the same orphanage that Robin and Haruki were from, she was a popular kart racer who was adored by her fans. A man with a strong build accompanied her, and they referred to him as Doctor. Haruki was warned by one of his friends that the aforementioned person was conducting experiments on human beings as well. Haruki always addressed Kiruko as sister, and the two shared a close bond. The following day, Haruki climbed onto a vantage point to view his sister's race. However, he spotted a camouflaged man-eater on the track. He pursued the man-eater and attempted to neutralize it. The race continued as no one was aware of the man-eater's presence. However, Kiruko and her competitors reached the arcade, where the man-eater was present. She then saw Haruki's body attached to the man-eater. Her instincts took over and she rushed to the scene immediately. She pulled Haruki's body from the man-eater's mouth, but was horrified to see that his entire lower body and limbs were missing. Despite this, Haruki was barely alive. A gunshot was then heard, and the next thing Haruki remembered was waking up in a hospital. He staggered and stumbled upon a mirror. He was horrified to see himself in Kiruko's body. He inquired about the doctor who treated him, who had fled from the town. The stitches around his skull were a clear indication that the doctor had fit Haruki's brain inside Kiruko. The next couple of weeks went by as Haruki attempted to make peace with the situation. He couldn't find Robin Inazaki or any other children from the orphanage. Haruki, who is now Kiruko, resolved to take on odd jobs in the hopes of finding Robin. This is how she came in contact with the people who requested her to be Maru's bodyguard. Maru now realized that it was Haruki who was in Kiruko's body and tried his best to process this rather disturbing information. After that, suddenly a fish with arms like man-eater appears on window. The fish monster that attacks the boat Kiruko and Maru are on proves to be a slippery customer. When Kiruko fires the Kira beam, it either misses or fails to fire, causing a large cloud of smoke and nothing else. But Kiruko notes the aqueous membrane around the man-eater and determines that the best place to fight it is not outside where it has access to all the water in the world, but inside the boat. Meanwhile, Cuckoo leads Tokyo to a ventilation hatch that leads to the babies. Cuckoo says she saw Tokyo doesn't have Cuckoo's astonishing physical gifts, so she uses one of the cleaner robots to give her a boost up to the hatch, which is located some 20 feet up the wall. Curiously, despite there being surveillance cameras pointed everywhere, including at this very hatch, neither Tokyo nor Cuckoo appear on the screen. After briefly arguing with the crew of the boat, Kiruko executes her plan, which relies on the fish following her and Maru using his Maru touch to kill it when he's able to touch it. That time comes when the fish is lured into a cargo bay full of boxes and dried marijuana, which sucks all the water away from the fish and dries it out. Maru is then able to finish the monster off just by touching its skin with his hand. Cuckoo takes Tokyo to a kind of weird laboratory nursery where even weirder babies are being raised with targets for faces. Tokyo puts her hand on the glass and one of the babes takes notice and even reaches out to her. An intruder alarm sounds and Cuckoo and Tokyo book it out of there, after which the baby calls Tokyo's name. What's odd is that the intruder alarm doesn't take the adults to the nursery where Tokyo and Cuckoo were. Once again, they don't appear on the surveillance monitors, but instead to another part of the facility entirely. Once they reach land, the gangster boat crew offers Kiruko and Maru cash for taking care of their man-eater problem. Kiruko refuses payment, since she and Haru had to act or be killed, but does ask if they recognize the bird logo on the Kira beam. They say it's the logo of a home goods store in the ruined town, but that turns out to be a completely different logo. Kiruko and Maru laugh about it while tucking into soup made from yukan. Tokyo watches Shiro take Mimihime by the hand and run off. She follows them and overhears Shiro asking about the nude photo Mimihime sent him, which she knows nothing about and has disappeared from his phone. He then tries to explain the urges he feels when he sees her, but comes up to her sounding like he wants to eat her. When Tokyo visits the critically ill Tereo, he tries to kiss her, but she recoils and runs off in a tizzy. Kona sees her running, follows her, and stays with her until she calms down. When she tells him how she's scared how everyone is acting so weird, he tells her there's no reason to be confused about people falling in love with one another. Tokyo then says if there's someone among them she wants to touch and be touched by, it would be Kona. Kona, in turn, says he'd like it to be her. This absolutely makes her day, and she goes to bed positively giddy, only to be interrupted by a summons to Tereo's hospital room, where he's asking for her. Once she arrives, he asks the adults to leave, apologizes for having tried to kiss her, and then tells her he's not going to get better, and she needs to run away, because this place is dangerous. Kiruko is seen trading a CD containing music by a rare artist. However, the CD was no longer functional and she couldn't get a good deal on it. Maru, on the other hand, was bored and decided to spend his time in an old arcade. He was picked on by a group of thugs. However, little did they know that Maru was excellent in hand-to-hand combat. He was able to beat them all up with ease. Just when one of them was about to escape, Kiruko got a hold of the thug and beat him up too. Following this, Maru explained how he met Mikura and how she trained him to kill man-eaters. Mikura even confirmed that he was the only one capable of killing them, which is why he is tasked with reaching heaven. Kiruko leaves Maru behind and decides to go in search of some more information. She overheard someone talking about the Ministry of Reconstruction and recollected a conversation that she once had with Robin regarding the same. Kiruko soon returned to the room, and she panicked since she couldn't find Maru. Soon Maru talks about the war collapse theory. According to this theory, humans built robots to make their lives easier. However, the human race had far too much time on their hands, and therefore started monitoring each other. This led to humans enforcing laws among themselves, which ultimately led to a war that marked the downfall of civilization. Within the walls, one of the staff members noticed a footprint in the incubation room. He became suspicious and decided to step outside where the children had gathered. They were dancing and playing music in the hopes of helping Tereo recover from the illness. Later that night, The staff member and the director gathered in the same room as Tereo, the ECG flatlined, and they noted his time of death. The students were notified about the news the next morning and they offered flowers at his funeral. Tokio asked Kona about Azura and how the person died, director talking about Azura's cause of death, which was suicide. Maru and Kiruko encountered a man from the ship who brought the remains of the man-eater. He was in search of a doctor who could keep one alive forever. Kiruko assumed that the man in question was the doc that she was searching for. However, the man had only heard rumors about this person. Tereo's remains are examined and it left behind a black-colored solid object with red accents. This horrified the director as they didn't know what the object was. Upon reaching the next town, they came across a young woman named Tadori, who had a hotel of her own. She offered the two a room to keep their belongings while they explored the place, which had 100% safe drinking water. Tadori showed them the way, and upon conducting an investigation, Maru and Kiruko found two injured men. That's when they encountered a wild bear that chased them. Kiruko used her kirabeam on a construction pole that fell on the bear and knocked it out cold. Maru was summoned to kill the bear with his Maru touch, which he renamed Fatal Dive. He was unable to do it, and the bear regained consciousness while he was in point-blank range. Maru and Kiruko then found an elevated spot that they climbed to save themselves from the bear. Kiruko wanted to give the battery some warmth, which is why she took it out of her kirabeam. However, she accidentally dropped it. Maru didn't want to climb down to get the battery since the bear was lurking around. Kiruko suggested the idea of Maru receiving permission to touch her chest if he went down to pick up the batteries. Knowing Maru's ulterior motives and his feelings towards Kiruko, he jumped down with no thought and picked up. He barely managed to escape the bear that was lurking around. Kiruko came up with a plan to kill the bear. Maru was asked to jump down and catch her when she jumped. He acted as a cushion and was instructed to run away. Kiruko fired two bullets into the bear's head with impeccable accuracy, killing it immediately. Kiruko realized that this was a trap that was set by the people in the town. The two managed to save Iwata, one of the injured persons and village chief. Maru immediately reminded Kiruko about her promise to him. She refused to comply for obvious reasons. Luckily, Tadori intervened just in time and saved Kiruko from Maru. She took him to his room and offered to perform acts of sexual nature for money. She undressed herself and placed Maru's hand on her chest. Maru's nervousness and excitement turned into fear when he was about to use his Maru touch on Tadori, who was a human being. He called Kiruko into his room, and she was shocked to see Maru with Tadori in his room, who was completely naked. The two apologized immediately, and Tadori didn't mind since she was the one who had initiated it. Within the walls, where Tokio was instructed to rest in a room, soon he saw Azura floating in the air, which startled him. However, he soon woke up and realized that it was a dream. The doctor in the facility gave Tokio a strange look that suggested suspicion. He matches the Tokio's shoes prints with the prints on wall earlier, but still confused how they couldn't visible on cameras. Tadori expressed her interest in becoming the hotel king. However, she was quite sad the following morning since Iwata had succumbed to his injuries. After reaching the region where they are supposed to find the Immortal Order, Kiruko and Maru realize that they cannot tell where to look. In the absence of any clue, they decide to put up a board to get hired for killing man-eaters. They camp at the same spot throughout the day, and after catching fish from a nearby river, they share a delicious meal in the evening. That's when, unbeknownst to them, the duo is spotted by the members of the Immortal Order. The guards tell a doctor about the two mysterious visitors and the board that they have put up. These men are then ordered by their boss to bring Maru and Kiruko to him. But by the time they get there, the duo is already taken to hiding by a group named Lithiumen that vehemently opposes the Immortal Order. The leaders of this faction explain to Maru and Kiruko that the members of the Immortal Order are engaged in a heinous experiment, through which they plan to achieve immortality by transferring human consciousness to machines. Interestingly, they also claim that their enemy group is also a man-eater locked up in the basement. Lithiumen offers to hire Maru and Kiruko to get the monster killed before it wreaks havoc anywhere. They plan a protest the following day to distract the guards and use that to their advantage. In the meantime, They snuck into Maru and Kiruko through a backdoor which is guarded by one of their double agents. After Kiruko and Maru successfully infiltrate the basement of the building controlled by the Immortal Order, they are surprised to notice how well lit the premise is. Kiruko feels that it's a sign that they potentially have the power supply for life support systems. However, the two friends could still not see any signs of a man-eater. That's when Maru points out that he has had a strange feeling about the whole mission from the very start. He feels that they're being set up and argues that there is a possibility that there are no man-eaters there. All of a sudden, Maru notices a man-eater on one of the cars in the basement. When Maru and Kiruko observe it closely, they are a bit relieved that their earlier suspicions were not right. But moments after Maru kills the small man-eater, they notice another one a few meters away, which eventually leads them to a larger one. Maru and Kiruko conclude that they have finally found the man-eater they have been looking for. When Kiruko points the gun towards it to complete the mission, she starts hallucinating. Kiruko is horrified by the visions of tens of man-eaters attacking her and Maru. She naturally panics and tries to kill them, but nothing appears to work as they start eating her slowly. Maru kisses Kiruko on the lips, and then she finally wakes up from her nightmarish illusions. He reassures her that everything is under control and she just had a hallucination. Maru then proceeds to kill the large man-eater as well. That's when a man in a black suit and a gun in his hand walks toward them. He looks at the man-eater and expresses his relief that the monster is finally dead. As he realizes that Maru and Kiruko had killed it, he asks for their help for some inexplicable reason. The two friends instead ask him about Dr. Yusami and are shocked when he reveals that he is standing right in front of them. While Maru and Kiruko are killing the man-eaters, the members of Livyaman stage a very vocal protest against Dr. Yusami and his men. Although things are peaceful at first, one of the protesters hurls a stone at the guards. This pisses the members of the opposite faction, who picks the stone and hurls it towards the protesters. Miss Muzahashi barely gets out of the trajectory of the projectile, but in doing so she falls off the shoulders of his men. Miss Muzahashi falls on her head and could not even stand on her own. She is immediately taken back to the headquarters, where the top leaders access her condition. That's when they learn that the man-eaters in the building have already been killed by Maru and Kiruko. One of the leaders realizes that this is just the right opportunity and tells the angry protesters that Miss Muzahashi is dead. He then convinces them to wage a violent protest against Dr. Yusami and his men, killing anyone who comes in their path. Meanwhile, Dr. Yusami takes Maru and Kiruko to a secluded room where he shows them a patient kept alive forcefully using several machines. He then explains to the duo that he is unnaturally extending her life only because once she dies, she will turn into a man-eater herself. Yusami asks Maru whether he can kill her using his powers, and after an inspection, the latter reveals that he can. It is later revealed that the patient's actual name is Hashio and she is Yusami's wife, who can communicate using a tablet. When Maru asks Hashio what she wants, she simply asks to see the sky before dying. Everyone works together to keep her final wish. Meanwhile, members of Livyaman have already started a war against Yusami and his men. When Hashio has looked at the sky as long as she wanted, Maru kills her using his powers. Before dying, she leaves a last message for Yusami in which she thanks him for letting her die as a human. Shortly after Hashio's death, Dr. Yusami meets his followers and informs them about the sad news. He tells everyone to go to a location on the map where they can start a new life. When asked why he is not going with them, Dr. Yusami tells him that he first wants to give his wife a respectful burial. Kiruko uses the chance to ask these people whether they know Robin by showing his picture. Interestingly, they recognize him as Dr. Inazaki, who was with them about 2 years ago. Robin, aka Dr. Inazaki, had great surgical knowledge according to the people, and he was learning Dr. Yusami's techniques as well. He once told them that he would not let anyone else die before mysteriously disappearing, never to be seen again. Later, Dr. Yusami takes Hashio's body to the terrace before the burial, while Kiruko and Maru wait outside the building. They are completely unaware of the fact that Yusami is quite depressed. While they discuss mundane life problems, Yusami sits quietly with his wife in his arms. Yusami looks at her face and kisses her forehead one last time. Then he pulls out a gun and kills himself. Maru and Kiruko rush to the terrace after hearing the loud bang and find his dead body there. While Maru feels that his power can only bring death and misery to the world, Kiruko tries to reassure him that he should not blame himself for everything. Meanwhile, the Whitecoats take control of the building where Dr. Yasami used to work, unbeknownst to the fact that there is still one alive man-eater in the basement. Before Azura's death, she was very close friends with Kona, and the two were basically inseparable. They used to discuss a lot of things, and things seemed quite normal apart from the fact that Azura never really revealed everything she knew. One evening, she decided to take her own life, and Kona has to unfortunately witness it happening right in front of his eyes. At the present time, one of the doctors at the facility notices something strange about Tokyo and calls her for inspection. Although she reassures her that everything is fine, her classmates are later informed that Tokyo won't be with them for a few days. However, the situation is left unexplained and she is taken for more medical tests. Elsewhere, Maru and Kiruko are still figuring things out after Dr. Yasami's suicide. When an earthquake strikes the city, one of the buildings collapses. Since Kiruko and Maru know that resource collectors may show up at the scene, they visit the location. That's when they meet a man named Juchi. Kiruko is curious to learn whether he has any information about the doctor or the logo. Juchi sees this as an opportunity to make money and tells the duo that information costs money. He then parks his car close to a building and proceeds to waste their time by telling two unrelated stories that are of little value. Kiruko eventually realizes that he is acting strange and scares him away with the kirabeam. After Juchi flees in his van, it finally becomes clear why he had parked the car on the side of the building even though the roads are always empty. It turns out that he was hiding the logo on the wall. The duo learns that it belongs to some Takahara Academy and starts investigating the building. After going through some stuff, Kiruko finds a message from the Takahara Academy's director, who refers to it as an educational institution and also a place where one can relax both body and mind. Kiruko then visits a room that Maru has just found. They notice a big hand-drawn graffiti of the logo that they have been looking for, and come to the conclusion that some bandits probably lived there at some point in time. Maru feels that there is a chance that the gun and the place he is looking for actually have no connection, but Kiruko interestingly points out that he is wrong. She hands over the pamphlet she has found earlier and tells him that the Takahara Academy was an orphanage. It also described the outside world as a hell of patience, and Kiruko feels that this is an indirect allusion of the heaven that Maru has been seeking. Interestingly, the pamphlet also mentions that Takahara Academy has two facilities and 18 branches altogether, and Chu, the director of the facility where Tokyo lives, holds an emergency meeting with everyone in the room. She announces the shocking news that Tokyo is pregnant. The entire staff is taken aback as the children in the facility have never been taught about sex or even the basic differences between men and women, and Chu is still in the dark about the identity of the child's father as the investigation is still ongoing, while Enchu refers to her facility as Takahara Academy. Maru and Kiruko seated in Juchi's car. Juchi reveals he was one of the breeding pigs who was jailed and forced to mate with the women who imprisoned him in the first place. He then managed to escape with the help of two women, one of whom was the mother. However, someone alerted the facility, and the women were hanged to death to make a statement to those who attempted to escape. The tattoo on his arm was real, and Kiruko decided to visit the faculty to check if Juchi's kid was still alive. Juchi was worried sick, but Maru and Kiruko went into the facility to confirm whether or not his son was alive. At this point, they were looking around for clues to see if anyone was around. However, in a split second, the duo felt cold and were on the verge of getting frostbitten. That's when they realized that it was the work of a Hiruko. The kirabeam helped them escape. After this, they confirmed that the entire facility was a ghost town, and they conveyed this message to a dejected Juchi. Two other men who were in the facility were shocked to see Juchi well and alive. They confessed to him that they had taken care of the child. They took him to the house where they lived, and Juchi had an emotional reunion with his child. The air was filled with joy and celebration. As Juchi was finally reunited with his kid, chaos ensued once again in the middle of the night when everyone felt the temperature drop to a dangerous level. That's when Kiruko realized that it was an attack by a Hiruko. She took Juchi's son and ran as far as she could, only to realize that the baby was the man-eater that caused the problem. However, the attack stopped as soon as the baby regained consciousness. The situation was neutralized, and things were back to normal once again. Juchi decides to stay with the other men and his child, so he gives Maru and Kiruko his van. Juchi later brutally kills the man who raised the alarm when he escaped from the walled town. Meanwhile in heaven, more children arrive at the facility. The director of the institution showed her true intentions during her interaction with Dr. Satari. She intends on using Aoshima, who was recently appointed as the deputy director of Takahara Academy. Dr. Satari soon realized that the director's choice of increasing her clearance level within the facility was to use her. Furthermore, there was a shot of the super beam which is now in Kiruko's possession. It was revealed that a surgical procedure to transfer the brain onto a new body was possible. With this, the director intended on living forever. The duo embarked on a journey to find more about Maru's goal. They decided to camp at an abandoned house. What intrigued them was a massive smoke that was seen in the distance at night. They wanted to be cautious, and therefore, decided to visit the place during the daytime. A shot of the facility showed a mysterious man walking around, and that person was none other than Robin Inazaki. Tokio successfully managed to give birth. Kona is clearly the father. Mimiheim told Kona about how she has the ability to see things that will happen in the future. What looks like an event that will take place years in the future seems to occur moments after she envisions them. On the other hand, events that seem to take place moments after envisioning them never seem to happen. It was scary because she saw Kona as a Hiroko. A rather vague announcement was made and the students assembled near the swimming pool. The good news was that Tokio was now allowed to attend classes with her classmates. Students had no idea what to do when the PA system announced that a test was about to commence. Students were asked to reach outside of outside and it referred to the students as Hirokos. Just moments later, an explosion occurs in academy and a huge projectile damaged the ceiling of the building. Chaos ensued, and students were running all over the place. The outer wall is breached and the children discover the world outside. Maru and Kiruko come across a bustling marketplace, but discover that chips are used for currency. They go to the Ministry of Reconstruction to register and obtain some, where Kiruko discovers that Robin is there. She is given an appointment to meet him later at the large filtration plant, which is on the site of the former Takahara Academy Ibaraki facility. At the appointed time, Kiruko goes there alone and explains to Robin that she is really Haruki in Kiruko's body, which causes Robin to suspect Sakoda did the operation. They had a ton of questions for each other and Robin asked Kiruko to take a shower. Little did she know that Robin was no longer the person she knew. He cuffed Kiruko to the bed and sexually assaulted her. Dr. Satari was panicking since the system went down, and he didn't know a way to differentiate the identical twins that Tokio gave birth to. Aoshima came rushing in, and he asked her about the commotion. She launched an investigation to find out what exactly happened. Meanwhile, the director, who seemed to be disabled, was able to get up from her wheelchair and run away. Mimiheim and her classmates saw a massive cavity in the wall. After getting all the children to safety, they stepped outside. They were shocked to see that there indeed was an outside of an outside. The fact that the ceiling was that high shocked everyone. Taka, Anzu, Shiro, and Mimiheim stepped out of the Takahara Academy's premises and continued exploring. The students assumed that this was a part of the test, and continued to think about the criteria for this test. Taka and Anzu went ahead to explore while Mimiheim and Shiro decided to head back inside and inform the rest of the class about the outside of the outside. Dr. Satari, who was accompanied by Aoshima and other engineers, they believed that the babies deserved to be handed over to Tokio. Aoshima decided to execute the Noah plan. She devised a strategy to safeguard the children of the academy. After what Robin did to her, Kiruko no longer knew who she was. She didn't know if she was Haruki or Kiruko. She did not wish to think and just wanted to obey orders. This was a clear sign of the trauma she had just experienced. Maru finally decides to search for Kiruko after 2 days. When the guards boast about hearing Robin and Kiruko's activities, Maru fights his way into the power plant and finds Kiruko tied up and naked. After looking at her for a second, he snapped and looked rather dead inside. He cornered Robin and took him to the ground with a single punch. While he lay there, Maru kept raining blows on Robin as his blood splashed onto his face. Maru continued to punch with no emotion until Kiruko begged him to stop. It took Maru everything he had to stop himself from hitting Robin. Maru confessed one more time, but this time he showed a great deal of maturity, stating that he liked Kiruko for who she is as a person, and not Kiruko or Haruki. Satari handed over the baby to Tokyo. The director threatened its existence, and asked the AI, Mina, to take it away. At this moment, Tokyo's eyes glowed blue and started morphing into a monster-like being while a flesh-like shell started to encase her and her child. A cheered-up Kiruko decides to tear the photo of Robin before they drive off to continue searching for heaven. Elsewhere, Mimiheim, Shiro, Taka, and Enzu are on a speedboat that is headed to a brightly lit city, confirming that the calamity had not taken place yet. So this is the end of anime. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you enjoyed it.